this video, we discuss the process of choosing the most suitable model for your research question. For this video, we will focus exclusively on one-dimensional or 1D, two-dimensional or 2D, and three-dimensional or 3D models. Let's start with one-dimensional models. If your case study is a deep lake and your study period is the summer when you see a strong thermal stratification and consequently strong concentration gradients in depth, you may not assume that the lake is vertically mixed. In this case, we usually have very low concentrations of dissolved oxygen in the bottom of the lake, which does not support higher aquatic organisms like fish. When you work with the average for the whole lake, you miss this important point. In this case, you may consider that you have distinct layers through the depths of the lake, and the concentrations of water quality variables in each layer may change in time. This makes it a one-dimensional model, since we have concentrations changing both over time and also in depth. The mass transport between layers occurs through two different transport mechanisms, advection and diffusion. Advection describes the transport of mass due to bulk motion, like fluid flow. We can imagine a smoke plume that changes its direction due to the wind blowing with a given velocity. We call this advective flow. The advection flux is equal to the velocity multiplied by the concentration. The units for advection fluxes are velocity, W in this example, measured in centimeters per second, times concentration, here measured in moles per centimeter cubed. Simplifying this, flux would have the units mole divided by square centimeter per second. Diffusion describes the mixing processes that cause the mass transport to spread out. The rate of diffusion is directly proportional to the concentration gradient and mass spread from a region of higher concentration to a region of lower concentration. Based on Fick's law, the diffusion flux, J, between two layers equals the negative of the diffusion coefficient, D, times the rate at which concentration changes with distance. Let's look at the units for diffusion flux. The diffusion coefficient has units such as centimeters squared per second. The gradient of concentration over a layer's depth, which we can simplify to dc over dx, has units of mole per centimeter cubed per centimeter. Again, this will simplify to moles per centimeter squared per second. Imagine the smoke plume again. Turbulent diffusion is what makes the plume spread out as it moves. The transport equation for 1D systems shows how the net change in concentration in each cell is equal to the rate of change of the turbulent diffusion and advection fluxes with distance plus or minus reactions that happen in the cell. In the case of a stratified lake, advection causes the particles in the lake to settle in the sediment due to the settling velocity of the particles. Moreover, the turbulent diffusion process causes the dissolved mineralized materials such as nitrogen and phosphorus in the deeper water layers of the lake to move upward. Let's look at the central basin of Lake Erie. The central basin of Lake Erie suffers from severe hypoxia during the summer. This means that during a period in the summer, lasting days or months, there is very little, with very little being defined as less than 2 milligrams per liter, or no oxygen, available for aquatic life in the lower layers of the central basin. Now, if we want to investigate hypoxia in the central basin of Lake Erie, we need at least a one-dimensional model, with that dimension being depth. Again, the biogeochemical complexity of our model will be defined by the number of species and processes we include in it. Please remember that complexity is not the same as dimensionality. Using this model, we can answer questions such as, how does the duration of hypoxia change annually in response to potential reductions in TP loadings into the central basin? Note that in this case, TP should be explicitly included in the model. The connection between TP and oxygen consumption and production should also be represented. No matter how much biogeochemical complexity you add to this 1D model, it will not answer questions like the following. How does hypoxia evolve in horizontal directions, either north-south or east-west, of the central basin over time? In this 1D vertical model, we can calculate the average concentration in each layer of depth, but we are not able to evaluate the oxygen gradients in horizontal directions. Let's discuss a two-dimensional model that has spatial resolution in two directions. Imagine that you have a long, narrow reservoir where the major water movement happens from upstream, a river inflow, to downstream, the outlet of a dam. And as a result, the nutrient concentrations do not change significantly throughout the reservoir's width. In this case, you can say that your reservoir is laterally averaged. You thus have concentrations of water variables changing in two directions, one horizontally from upstream to downstream, here the x-axis, and one vertically from the surface to the bottom of the reservoir, here the z-axis. As a result, your grid would look like this. Here, advection and diffusion happen in both the x and z directions, as seen in the transport equation. Accordingly, the concentrations of water quality variables change in the x and z directions due to physical transport, diffusion and advection, and biogeochemical processes. If the proper amount of biogeochemical complexity is added to represent the nutrient phytoplankton dynamics, two-dimensional water quality models are suitable for modeling eutrophication in long, narrow reservoirs. Finally, let's discuss 3D models. In cases where we have significant gradients in water quality variables in all three directions, that is, the body of water is not fully mixed in any direction, we cannot reduce the dimensions of this model. If you are modeling a large, deep lake in the summer, for example, you will see large variations in water quality variables in the x, y, and z directions due to lake circulation events such as upwelling. In these models, advection and diffusion transport the mass in horizontal directions x and y, as well as vertically along the z-axis. The differences between advection and diffusion fluxes, plus reactions inside each cell, define the net change in concentration in the cell over a specific time step. Here we return to modeling hypoxia in the central basin of Lake Erie in summer, when we usually see strong water quality gradients between the surface and bottom of the lake. Phytoplankton are usually found in high concentrations in surface water, along with higher temperature and pH. Bottom water, however, tends to have high iron and manganese concentrations and be hypoxic, with lower temperature and pH. A research team led by scientists from the Cooperative Institute for Great Lakes Research and the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration's Great Lakes Environmental Research Laboratory is developing an experimental 3D model for forecasting hypoxia in Lake Erie. This model is coupled to a real-time, fine-scale, hydrodynamic model that has been derived mainly from meteorological factors. You see the results of this 3D model with simulated hypoxia for mid-August 2019 on the screen. Using this model, you can see in real time how the hypoxia evolved in Lake Erie. The goal of this project is to provide advance warning for water treatment facilities that hypoxic water is likely to move toward them. Note that these models cannot be used for long-term predictions, because we do not have long-term predictions of meteorological data, which are the main drivers of this hydrodynamic model. Also, keep in mind that it is expensive to build, maintain, and run the powerful computers that are capable of running these models. And now, to sum up what we have learned in this video. To find the right model to answer your question, you must ask yourself the following. Are you focusing on the behavior of the whole system or on the behavior of the individual parts of a system? Are you evaluating the short-term behavior and responses of a system to stressors, or are you hoping to gain insights into the long-term behavior of a system? What level of spatial, temporal, and biogeochemical details are required to address the specific research question? We brought several examples that help you gain insights into how to choose the right model. You saw that, for example, 1D models are helpful for stratification modeling in deep lakes. 2D models are suitable for modeling eutrophication in long, narrow reservoirs. And 3D models are great tools for forecasting the evolution of eutrophication in short time periods.